Rather be faithful. rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus
songs just remind me of who I hold on to. Okay, now we're going to come to a time of prayer in a moment or two. We're going to sing another song before that. Well, I am. You can read the words. But this reminds us that if we hold on to Jesus, what a friend he is to us. And the importance of talking with them about all that concerns us. Now, I don't know about any particular prayer needs that have been brought in, but I have a few that I would like us to pray for. Morag is not with us today. Now, Howard can fill me in on this, whether it's so, but I believe she has an appointment to have her hip replaced on Thursday, is that right? So let's pray for Morag. If you've watched her recently walking about, you'll see that there is a need, and she has now got the opportunity to have that operation on Thursday. So let's be thinking of Morag. And I have three other people that I would like to pray for. My own brother Richard, a friend of his called Fred, and my brother-in-law, Jenny's older brother, Michael. They all have problems with their prostate. My brother, who I was speaking to recently, says it's causing him a great deal of pain. His friend Fred almost cries out in pain with the trouble he has. And Michael is concerned because not only has he trouble with his prostate, he also has trouble with his bladder. So they're all concerned, so we need to pray for God's healing hand on those three. And also, I think we need to be praying for peace in Israel and what is going on at the moment. Only God can bring it about. I can't see it happening any other way. And I think that we have to pray for these particular things. Now, is there anything else that anybody else would like us to be praying for this morning? Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Because tomorrow things are opening up. We'll all be allowed to hug each other. Well, we won't all be allowed to hug each other. There'll be certain people that we'll be allowed to hug, let's put it that way. But it's all got to be part of the sense of it. Yes. Yeah. Pray that you will follow God's guidance as to where you go from this church, or whether you stay in the sort of ministry that is following on from this. I hope I can give you some guidance in my little message at the end. Yes. Yeah. Yep. Okay. Good. I do have trepidations about taking this service, I must admit, knowing who's possibly watching me. Well, let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you are with us. And we can always turn to you. And what a friend you are to us, Lord. Lord, we do pray for the concerns that we have had. Lord, we pray for Morag on Thursday when she has her operation. We pray that that will go well. Watch over her, we pray. We pray for your healing hand upon Richard and Fred. And Michael. Lord, watch over them. Be with them in whatever treatment they are receiving. But most of all, Lord, we pray that you would lay your healing hands upon them. We pray for Vic's brother, Lord. We pray for other members of our families. Those that know you and those that don't. We pray that they may come to know you. But Lord, we pray most of all that you would watch over families and our friends at this time. We pray for some of the things that are going on in the world, Lord, at the moment. We pray for the trouble that there is in Israel and Palestine. And Lord, we pray that you may influence what is going on and bring about this an end to this senseless destruction and death that is being meted out at the moment. We pray that your love may enter men's hearts. Lord, we just pray for that situation. We pray that you will take control. And Lord, we pray for our own country as it opens up after this pandemic. Lord, that we will have sense about the way that we deal with it and the way we go about it, and that we will be careful, not careless. Lord, watch over us, we pray, in all of this. And Lord, I thank you that you'll be with us now as we continue in this service. Help us to know your love and your presence. Lord, we ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Yes. Yes. Right, well, let's look at our next song, which reminds us again of where we can turn and who we can hold on to. Now, before our Bible readings and all that I have to say, I know that Anne would like to say something to us. Yes? Come up the front.
Thank you very much. And if there's any mic you want, so that mic is on camera, whatever mic you want, your choice.
You stand.
stand here. Can everybody hear me? Why not?
Stand here.
This one?
Yes.
Can you hear me, Mother?
Yes, we can see you too.
Oh, dear. I'd like to just say a couple of verses of a hymn. You're fortunate in that I'm not going to sing it, I'm going to say it. So this hymn has meant so much to me over so many years. Right. I do not know what lies ahead, the way I cannot see, but one stands near to be my guide. He'll show the way to me. I know who holds the future, and he'll guide me with his hand. With God, things don't just happen. Everything by him is planned. So, as I face tomorrow, as we face tomorrow, with its problems, large and small, I'll trust the God of miracles. Give to him my all. Amen. God bless.
Thank you, Anne. Do we have our Bible readings on the screen?
Yes.
Thank you. Right, I have a couple of Bible readings before I say anything that I want us just to look at.
Second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. And from Corinthians, if I speak the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres.
Now I read those verses at my mother-in-law's funeral, and it really sort of struck me as I read them. And I think it also struck at the hearts of all of those that were at the funeral. Now, If you looked at the first part of that saying from Paul about love, he explained quite clearly to those that were listening to him that he was going to talk about a most excellent way, and that was love. Now, when I first attended this church, that was what stood out to me, the love that I experienced in this church. This church brought me back to Jesus. I'll just explain a few things to you. When I was a child and a teenager, I was sent to church by my parents. I went to the Sunday school of our local church. I eventually joined the choir of our local church. I even sang in St. Paul's Cathedral. I've got a medal back at home to prove that I was there. My brother and I were both in the choir. So I knew the Lord. I used to pray to him. I used to talk to him. But then I became a teenager, and things got in the way. Drink. Girls. But fortunately, I eventually met Jenny when I was at college. And thank the Lord I did. But at college, I must admit, I probably turned away from the Lord. We had a Songs of Praise service at our college, and everybody wanted to go to it. And I just thought, what a load of hypocrites. They just want to be on telly, because the whole thing was televised. But I basically had drifted away from the Lord until I moved to Harriet Martineau, just up the road. On a Sunday morning, I found myself annoyed at children playing in the garden of the house next door. They were busy singing hymns and songs. It was a bit of a nuisance, I thought, at the time. But then we started getting to know our neighbours, the Brummets. I don't know if anybody remembers them. Yep, Vic's got his hand up. And at that time, Jenny's father was very ill, and Jenny had to spend some time going up there to see him, which left me on my own with the children. I had to look after them, feed them, and so forth. But gradually, Jenny got in touch with our neighbours, and they invited her to come to their local church, which was this one. And Jenny went to that church on her own for a while and left me at home. But eventually she persuaded me to come along here. And I thought, oh, do I really need to? But I did. I came along to the church, and the church was full then. Full of Americans. And some English people as well. But there was a lot of people here, yeah. It was a fairly full house. But after a while, I began to realize that they were interested in me. And the more I listened, and the more they expressed their love for me, the more I wanted to start to know more about Jesus. And I started talking to him again. We had friends in another church, and one of their little boy was a friend of my son, Tom. and we looked after them for a while. But eventually, this little boy got ill, and unfortunately, he died. And I couldn't understand that, but his mother explained that God had given him her son, and he had taken him away. But she appreciated the time she'd had with him. And she said she was praying for us, Jenny and I. And I was amazed at that. Struck me here. I got angry. Angry with God. And I started talking to him. I started talking to him in this church. And he started talking to me. The love and the support of the people in this church for Jenny and I was amazing. Eventually, I heard that Jenny was going to be baptized. And we were going down to the church. But the baptism wasn't going to take place in the church. It was going to take place at Nettleshall Heath, where there's a river flows through. So all of the church went to Nettleshall Heath to see this happen. And I stood there and watched everything that was going on. And I remember Trevor and Brian Hogwood, they stood in the river, and one or two people were being baptized. Jenny was one of them. And I watched this, and I watched Jenny. Sorry, I'm quiet. I've just been struck down. No, I watched Jenny go in anyway and get baptized. And I went and hid behind some trees while I watched this go on. And as I stood there was nobody there. I felt a hand on my shoulder. Nobody there. And I looked again down at the river and felt that hand on my shoulder. I went down to that river and got baptized. Praise the Lord. Right, from that point on, I really got involved in the church. Because of the love of God's people in that church, in this church, I really got involved. I got involved in children's ministries. In fact, Jenny and I actually led it at one point. We took holiday Bible clubs and things like that. And the pastor, Trevor, then got me doing adult Bible studies. And I thought this was quite surprising, because I had to get back to the Bible and start reading it again. And I started doing Bible studies and things like that. And this was all brought about by the love, the Christian love that I experienced in this church. I knew the Lord. I'd come back to the Lord. He held my hand. He guided me. He led me on. And I couldn't doubt the love of his people. And I did my best to express that. Now, I don't know where you're going to go from this point on with this church. I hope we all keep in touch. But I hope you find another church where you experience Christ's love in all that you see and all that goes on. I hope you do. because that love was really strong. Now, I did have a surprise at one point, though. And I can't tell you what a big surprise this was. We've read what Christian love is all about. We read it up there. Let me just find it in a minute. One of the things that went on in this church was it was a very hospitable church. You know, you'd get invited out for meals and such like by the people that were in there. And one day, we got invited to a meal. And we were glad to go. I'm not going to mention any names or any pack grills. I just really want to mention something that really surprised me. Having experienced the love that there was in the church, we went along for this meal with people that we regarded as friends in the church. And we all sat down for our meal, and we were about to say grace, when suddenly our hostess said, before we say grace, I want to tell you why we invited you here. And Jenny and I looked at each other, rather surprised, about to enjoy this meal. And then she said, we've invited you here because we can't stand you. We really are... You really get on our nerves. And Jenny and I sat there. I was struck dumb a minute ago. So were Jenny and I. We looked at each other. I think our mouths hung open. Because suddenly this was a big shock. I'd been in a church which had shown me great love. And I thought I was going along to a nice meal with people that loved us. But they stood there and they said, we've invited you here because we can't stand you. Well, after we eventually collected ourselves, we said, well, what is it? Why is it you can't stand us? And they said, well, you've come into this church. You're getting involved in everything. You're taking it over. And I said, no, we're not. I said... We've come into this church because God has led us here. God is telling me to do these things. The pastor told me to do the Bible, adult Bible studies. And I said, we're awfully sorry, though we didn't realize we had anything to be sorry for, but we apologize to these people. Now, sometimes this thing does happen in church, and it was staggering to us, but that's the only time that it has ever happened. But when you look at Christian love, what does it say? It says we're not supposed to fall out with people. It says we're supposed to love everybody. God told us, Jesus told us, even to love our enemies. Difficult though that may seem, because as far as Paul said in his message, that is the only way we can go. We have got to love people. We may not like the way they behave. We may not like what they do. But if we show them Christian love in the same way I experienced when I came into the church, if we show that, we will win other people for the Lord by the way that we behave. I saw a little item on the news which really struck at me, and this was something that was going on in Israel at the moment. There was an Arab chappie, Arab Christian, I think it was in Jerusalem itself, like I can't remember exactly where it was, who ran an ice cream parlor. And it was attacked by Israeli youths. And they virtually smashed the place up. And after this had happened, this man was so upset, he couldn't understand it. But he was visited by a group of Christian Jews, Christian Israelis, people who knew Jesus. And they came to support him and help him to rebuild his business. That's the sort of love that we need to show in the world out there. We need to reach out and show Christ's love. God, Christ loved us. Christ loves us. He wants us to love others. He wants us to love people into the kingdom. There may be someone you know that you don't get on with. There may be someone who annoys you. I had a chappie at work. He was a practical joker. He was one of my best friends at work. And he knew what I was like. He knew I was a Christian from all the things that I'd discussed with him. He knew that I did my best to show him Christian love. But it didn't stop him being annoying. And he often used to play practical jokes on me. But that didn't stop me loving him. And he said, why don't you fight back? You know, why don't you have a go at me for that? And I said, because I don't need to. Yes, you are annoying, I said to him, but I still love you. There is a difference between loving and liking. You may not think that, but I do. We're not supposed to bear grudges. We're not supposed to resent. We are supposed to love. We are supposed to admire. We are supposed to reach out. We are supposed to show the love that Jesus first loved us. We need to show that love. He loved us enough to give his life for us. And that's what I have experienced, that love in this church. And I hope the love that we had in this church goes out wherever you go. Let me give you a bit of advice. It was God's love that lifted me. It's God's love that will lift you. If you experience God's love and you express it, go out and find it wherever you go in your next church. Wherever it may be, you may still cling on to this church to a certain extent. You may even come to the Liberty Church. It's good that the Liberty Church is taking this over. You know, this, it may have come to an end in here, but the good work that was done by this church is going out elsewhere. Energies will be spent with the King's Lynn Church. The Church of the Nazarene is still going. All right, we may have not become a viable church as such, but the ministry is going out elsewhere. We have the Dove Ministry, which is being very successful apparently at the moment. We may still be invited back into this church for, from what I've heard, maybe the odd service here and there. I would find it difficult to celebrate the end of this church, but that's neither by the by. So let me tell you, love lifted me. Love brought me to this church. I experienced love in this church. I can still see people sitting in front of me now that were part of this church when I joined it. And thank you for your little message a moment ago. That encouraged me too. Do you know, I don't feel so sad as I did now, standing here. You find Christ's love. You go out and find it. And you continue to express it. Express Christ's love to all the people that you know. All the people that you have influence with. Show that love. Don't hold on to bitterness. Don't hold on to resentment. Hatred of anything should not be part of it. Show your love. Go where you think you are being loved. Loved by the Lord. That can be seen in his people. Those that show his love to those that they know. Love lifted me. Go and find that love in the next place that you go to. It might be a church, I don't know what it may be. But in so doing, don't lose touch with those that are sitting around you now and those that you did know that were in this church. Hold on to that. Maybe this church has served its purpose. But take that, what this church has achieved, out there. Take Christ's love somewhere else. Keep it going. Love lifted me. Love lifts us all. Christ's love is the only thing that will bring peace into this world. It's the only thing that will make this world better. Let's carry Christ's love out to the world. Find it in the next church or the next group that you meet with. Share that love. Love lifted me. That's going to be our last hymn. And then we're going to close with a blessing. Take that with you. The Lord is still with us, and we can take him as we go on. He may be closing one door, but he is opening others. Praise the Lord. Love lifted me. Thank you.
make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.
Lord, turn his face toward you
and give you peace. Lord, bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you
and be gracious to you.
The Lord turn his face toward you
and give you peace.
From heaven, this isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. And the children, may his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, he is for you, he is for you. It's
Pray the Lord. Pray that the Lord will guide you and keep you and show you to your next spiritual home.